My name is Ashley Jones, and I'm the founding director of the Magic City Culinary Festival. Welcome to our keynote event. Before we get started, before I tell you about our readers, I have a few announcements and thank yous that I want to do. So first, we want to thank our sponsors. We want to thank the AWC, which is a writing organization in Alabama, supporting a diverse community of writers. We have a few members here tonight who are happy to talk about what we do, so just come up and ask one of us. We have an annual conference in June that's at Orange Beach this year, so if you are a writer or somebody who likes writing, definitely check that out. It's going to be really nice. We want to thank PEN America and Kyle Dacian, who's in the back, for supporting this event, for sponsoring this event. Without them, this would literally not be possible. PEN works hard to ensure free speech and literature are able to prosper all over the world, and we're very grateful for their presence here in Birmingham. This event comes to you as part of PEN's Press Freedom Incentive Fund, which seeks to examine the role of media in our nation's progress and protection of free speech, which is vital to the success of our democracy. Later tonight, Kyle's going to come up and talk a little bit more about PEN and PEN involved. We also want to thank Cal at Church Street Coffee and Books for providing refreshments for this and for two of our other events. Church Street not only sells coffee and pastries, but they also have a really great book selection, so stop into their store to get some great books. We want to thank Ann Bailey and Green Bucket Press. They donated the banner that you saw outside. Make sure to take pictures in front of that before you leave. And also, they are selling voice book journals that are specific to the festival. They've also done a podcast called Present Tense Podcast, and two of those episodes are dedicated to the festival, so definitely check that out on iTunes. We also want to thank the Desert Island Supply Company, at which we will close the festival on Saturday. And Disco not only donated that space for Saturday, but they also facilitated the creation of our festival t-shirts, which are actually for sale tonight. So if you want one, we can get you one tonight.
Yeah.
How much are they?
Bringing the shirts.
Do you know how much they are?
They are $20. $20 each. And they're very comfortable. And they are also hand-pressed by our friend Chris Eisenhower at Make Birmingham.
Like 20 minutes.
They are not off the press. Not off the press.
And they're good for, they'd be good for walking because nobody's giving you, they're bright.
They're so bright, thank you. Yes, they're bright, they're lightweight, perfect for summer. Gold is the end color this season. You can trust me on that. I do follow the fashion. So thank you to Disco for that. And all the proceeds from the Silver Shirts benefit the Woodlawn Writers Corps, which is the program that they do at Putnam Elementary. We also want to thank the Alabama State Poetry Society and the Naked Art Gallery for sponsoring Thursday nights, which is tomorrow. I throw it on myself, tomorrow is Thursday. Thursday night's Wine, Cheese, and Poetry Open Mic. I'm really grateful for them for sponsoring that event. We also want to thank Studio 2500 for hosting our opening on Monday night, and its director, Willie Williams Jr., who's in the audience right now. If you have any events that you want to host at a gallery, please talk to that guy because he has space that is ready for you. We also want to thank Birmingham Stands and Tim, who is somewhere, Sam, there he is, and Crystal for coming and doing their What Do I Stand For boards outside. And we're so grateful for the work that they do to promote unity in our city. We also want to thank Birmingham Civil Rights Institute for working with us on this event to provide this beautiful space. If you have not visited the museum itself, please do so as soon as possible. It's a really transformational experience to walk through the exhibits. I'd also like to say a special thank you to festival organizer Lena Stefanescu, who's at the back. There she is right there. Honestly, she has helped so much with this entire festival and specifically with this event. We went up to Penn's offices. Lena rescued me from my illness, and she took me to the ER. So I just want to say thank you to her for all that she has done and will do to make this festival happen. And if you take any videos or pictures tonight in front of our banner or just in general, please use our hashtag Magic City Poetry Festival so we can share all of those photos and videos that you take. All right. So tonight, as some of you may know, we commemorate the 50th anniversary of the assassination of the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. On April 4th, 1968, one of the most powerful and transformational civil rights leaders was silenced in body, but the spirit of his work and his words have lived on throughout this half century since his death. Also on this date, we celebrate the birth of one of poetry's giants, the late Dr. Maya Angelou. So before I introduce the readers, I wanted to read a little bit of her work just to sort of bless the room. I do that all the time. I like blessing spaces, just so I feel more comfortable in them. So I'm going to read the final two stanzas of her iconic poem, Still I Rise. Out of the huts of history's shame, I rise. Up from a past that's rooted in pain, I rise. I'm a black ocean, leaping and wide, welling and swelling, I bear in the tide. Leaving behind nights of terror and fear, I rise. Into a daybreak that's wondrously clear, I rise. Bringing the gifts that my ancestors gave, I am the dream and the hope of the slave. I rise, I rise, I rise. And my hope is that through this conversation, we'll all rise a little bit together tonight. So our first reader is Jacqueline Allen Tribble, and I'll read her bio before she comes up. Jacqueline Allen Tribble lives and writes in Montgomery, Alabama, where she is a professor of English and chairs the Department of Languages and Literatures at Alabama State University. Her work has appeared in various publications, including the Louisville Review, The Offing, and Blue Lake Review. American Happiness, her first collection, published by New South Books, won the Falcon S. Poetry Prize. She is currently a Kaveh Kanwa Fellow and the recipient of a 2017 Literary Arts Fellowship from the Alabama State Council on the Arts. Please welcome Jacqueline Tribble.
An introduction. And I thought, what? More homework? And so I had no idea what to write. You know, I'm a teacher, so my first thought was to write about craft. But I sat down at my computer, as many writers do, and I just started writing something, whatever fell out of my head. And the first sentence that fell out of my head was this one. My mother was a foot soldier in the fight for civil rights, had a cross burned on her lawn, drove students to Lanier, a local high school, to integrate it, and was sued along with CBS for comments she made on television. So I began to tell this story about my mother, and even though I sort of missed most of the civil rights movement, I did spend a lot of my childhood falling asleep in MIA meetings and at SCLC conventions and that kind of thing. And so I just want to read just the end, the very end of this little thing that gives you a sense of where my poetry comes from. And it really comes from my mother. In the fall of 1968, I went to Edward T. Davis Elementary. My mother made sure of it. My father had died earlier that year, and my mother, who is actually my stepmother, was determined to raise me as she thought my father would have wanted. That meant I was going to get the best education she could find. So, I became the only black child in Davis Elementary that year. I joined the Brownies, and my mother joined the PTA. Whatever minor skirmishes or major wars ensued behind my being at that school, I never heard of them. In those days, children minded children's business, and adults minded their own. What I do know is that fall, my mother volunteered to read poems at the fall festival. Dressed in a long, flowing skirt and a peasant blouse, she played the part of fortune teller. Children and adults alike lined up at her small booth to have Mama gaze into her magic eight ball and tell their future. I was dressed as a ghost. There I was, the only little black child in the whole school, wandering the halls of the festival in a sheet with a pointed pillowcase hat in which my mother had cut two little eye holes. It was years before I understood why my mother laughed and laughed and took so many pictures of me in my white sheet that night. Even then, she was teaching me the power and pleasure of ironic juxtaposition, a lesson that continues to inform my sense of humor as well as my poetry. And that little introduction was titled, How My Mother Taught Me to Write Poetry. So. Writing an article, more homework, about the Andy Griffith Show, because it struck me that the two most important shows in the late 60s were the Andy Griffith Show and Gentle Ben. Gentle Ben was number one, Andy Griffith was number two. They starred Clint Howard in Gentle Ben and Ron Howard, his brother, in the Andy Griffith Show. And they were both about Southern law enforcement. And Gentle Ben was about a Everglades park ranger, and of course, we all know Sheriff Andy. Even if you've never seen it, you know about Andy and Barney. And so my argument was that the reason we love these shows so much was because they constructed a South, an America we imagined but didn't really have. It's like Disney World. We prefer the America in our head to the America we actually live in. So I wrote this poem, and it's called American Happiness. It used to be in Mayberry. Folks were never colored, not even black and white, but beige, khaki, a little gray. In Mayberry, Deputy Barney had one bullet and no need for rope. The only burning he did was for his Thelma Lou. The sheriff had no gun, just an Aunt Bee baking pies, and an Opie full of freckles heading off to fish or sing or court, whatever Opies do. In Mayberry, no doors were barred or locked. The jail was mostly empty. The only water hose we ever saw lay peacefully curled on Sheriff Andy's lawn. Mayberry was a southern town. Technicolor must have killed it. Made Andy a cranky lawyer, sent Opie running all the way to Hollywood. But we remember black and white. From Chicago to Watts to Selma, we tuned in to connect the dots of Opie's face while we dined on mashed potatoes and buttered corn right before our TV sets. Mesmerized that in this southern town, the sheriff used his hose to water Aunt Bee's roses. We were so happy and relieved. We laughed until we could not think, until we fell off our sofas and wingbacks and cane bottoms. We laughed until we could not see or hear, until we could forget that outside our own windows, other sheriffs with loaded guns, snarling dogs, and ready hoses made quick work of a world on fire. Pocket bottles. Do not pretend you are surprised when a man he has never seen accosts him for thinking sidewalks are free for all. When they bring his limp brown body to your door and tell you how he brought it on himself was much, much too uppity to live. When they praise the one who shot him dead and stood his ground, do not scream and cry and cuss. Do not pick up your weapon and kill his killer. Do not blame the jurors for being blind. Say nothing, say nothing, say nothing. Smile and bury your only son. Smile and calm the crazy crowd. Smile and forgive, forgive, forgive. Forgiveness covers centuries of sin. When they knock at last at your own front door, get up, sure-footed, from the bed you have made. Get your children and your husband up too. Do not stomp your feet in protest. Do not wave the cane stalk of your arm in protest. Do not explain that you are worthy and smart. Do not say you have sacrificed enough. Go quietly into the trucks. Go quietly into the long train cars. Go quietly into the dark ovens, like the coward you are. Thank you very much.
Southern writer, born and raised in Jackson, Mississippi. Lehman attended Millsaps College and Jackson State University before graduating from Oberlin College. He earned an MFA in fiction from Indiana University. Lehman is currently a professor of English and African American Studies at the University of Mississippi and a distinguished visiting professor of nonfiction at the University of Iowa. Lehman is the author of the novel Long Division and a collection of his essays, How to Slowly Kill Yourself and Others in America, the UK edition released in 2016. Lehman has written essays, stories, and reviews for numerous publications, including Esquire, McSweeney's, New York Times, ESPN Magazine, Colorlines, NPR, Lit Hub, Los Angeles Times, The Guardian, Penn Journal, Theater, Oxford American, Best American Series, Ebony, and Guernica. He is contributing editor of Oxford American. Welcome, KSA.
Putting this together, as we all know. pots of people, and it often takes at least one mastermind, and that mastermind often is also very sweaty, right? Because there's a lot of stuff on the ground people have to do, so thank you so much. I want to thank Kyle, who I just had dinner with, and Penn, and I want to thank Elena for being amazing and talking to me over internet, email. Not good at returning emails, but she's very persistent, so I'm thankful. I'm very thankful for that. All right, y'all, so about 3 weeks ago, Roxane Gay asked me to write this essay for this project she has called Unruly Bodies. And I told her that I would do it, and she said, what do you want to write about? And I was like, I guess I want to write about violence and my body, my black body, and violence, and particularly about guns. And I really, this essay started off really as exploration of why I do not have children and why I'm afraid of having children. And then it went sort of different places, and here we go. All right, the title of the piece is, I'm a big black man who will never own a gun because I know I would lose it. I wonder, while sitting on a sturdy porch across the road from William Faulkner's house in northern Mississippi, if President Trump and the Mississippi legislature really want big black men like me to carry guns into our classrooms. As a black child from central Mississippi, my mother and teachers encouraged me to imitate the work of William Faulkner. My mama thought imitating Faulkner could protect me, ironically, from white men's power, and all men's bullets. By the time I was 15, I'd read everything Faulkner had written. I knew my Faulkner like I knew my Ice Cube, my Voltron, my En Vogue, my Good Times, my Banana Now Laters. I loved knowing that Faulkner's literary virtuosity was inflected by his real and imagined experiences with black Mississippians. But somewhere around 11th grade, my body tired of imitating white writers who simply could not see, hear, love, or imagine black folk as part of or central to their audience. I especially tired of white writers from Mississippi, who in my estimation had enough deeply Southern home training and proximity to the ways of black folk to know and to be better. When Callie Barr, a black woman paid to clean up after the Faulkners, died in 1940, Faulkner delivered her eulogy. He said, from her, I learned to tell the truth, to refrain from waste, to be considerate of the weak, and respectful to age. I saw fidelity to a family which was not hers, devotion and love for a people she had not born. Of course, black fidelity and devotion to white families is a terrifying part of our story in this nation. And of course, there was a lot that Faulkner could not see in Callie Barr's work, because white Americans, regardless of region, often have no clue the shape of the stories told and the depth of the truth concealed under the timber of our voices and the greased creases of our smiles. Still, I always believe Faulkner's lessons learned from Callie Barr's supposed devotion fidelity were foundational to any national or individual reckoning with American violence. Tell the truth, refrain from waste, consider the weak, respect age. Like my grandmother, Callie Barr spent most of her time cleaning up after white folk. Unlike Callie Barr, Grandmama never lived close to the houses of the white family she took care of. The house that Callie Barr and her family lived in is directly behind Faulkner's house. From the front of Barr's porch, one looks directly into the back of the Faulkner home. The porch of Barr's house, held up by weakened cement, has one screen door in the middle and two doors on either side. The porch is worn and wobbly, just like the porch I grew up in on Forest, Mississippi, just like the porch I grew up on in Forest, Mississippi. Unlike Callie Barr, my family did not have to look at anything white owned from our porch. We did not own much, but we owned our shotgun house. We owned our porch. We owned our small swath of land. We owned our garden, our Bibles, our books, our cinder blocks, our pecan trees, our sticker bushes, and we owned our guns. Those guns, shotguns specifically, and the story surrounding those shotguns always reminded me that my deeply black southern family had neither devotion nor fidelity to white folk who could not see us. White folk who could not see us, sometimes led by police and almost always led by presidents and public policy, had no problems finding creative ways to encourage our death, destruction, and suffering. They could not see us, but they could always see our guns, whether those guns existed or not. Still, as good Christians, we often prayed for them, and we said things like, bless their heart. They really know not what they do. However, if they ever knew not what they did on our property, near our porch, against the bodies of our families, they were going to get shot or shot at. This is not a metaphor. I've walked to Cali Bar's porch every day of this month looking and really listening for something. Last night, I think I heard it. After Emmett Till was tortured and shot in the head by grown white men with no devotion and no fidelity to him, 75 miles from where I now live, Faulkner wrote, if we in America have reached that point in our desperate culture when we must murder children, no matter for what reason or what color, we do not deserve to survive and probably won't. If William Faulkner loved, or at least imagined, what Callie Barr saw happening to her children, what her children saw happening to her, or even what Barr and her children saw happening to the Faulkner family, he could never say, if we in America reach that point in our desperate culture when we must murder children. Faulkner would have known that you cannot love any child in the United States of America if you refuse to accept that the nation was born of a maniacal commitment to death, destruction, and the suffering of black, brown, and indigenous children, and a moral annihilation of white children. Mm-hmm. Faulkner would have accepted that there has never been a time in this desperate nation's history when American grown folk have refused to murder their children. This is not breaking news. This is not a deep reading of our nation's habits. This is not progressive. It's not remotely radical. This is wholly descriptive. This is also why Donald Trump is president, why gun violence is the leading cause of death in this country, why a nation that parades its big guns thinks it has the moral authority to audaciously tell its children and its quote-unquote black folk what to do with our little guns. This is why we talk so much about the stock market and so little about income inequality, why mass incarcerations, mass evictions, mass sexual violence, and mass shootings are American specialties, why 17 people were killed in Parkland, Florida last month, why Stephen Clark was shot 20 times in his grandmama's backyard, why thousands of children will die before the summer, and hundreds of thousands more cannot afford healthy breakfast, lunch, and dinner, why we are a nation of addicts, super quick to diagnose other people's addictions, why so many of us long to be skinnier, but not healthy, why we are obsessed with forgetting what we don't want to be true, why we never admit that we are really good at violence because schools, churches, politicians, and parents taught us to be really good at violence. And it's also why Donald Trump, the worst of men, the worst of white folk, the worst of Christians, has encouraged some teachers to come to school armed. And why the Mississippi House of Representatives just passed House Bill 1083 that would presumably allow big black teachers like me to carry guns into our classrooms, all in the name of safety and order and freedom and love. This, and the fact that America has always been a desperate culture where grown Americans encourage and sanction the murder and suffering of his children, make me afraid to ever own or handle a gun. I know I would use it. I'm a big black man who does not have children because I've been taught that guns are how men, big and small, black, Latinx, white, protect their children from violence in America. My grandmama used a gun. My mama used a gun. For a while as a teenager, I used a gun. I stopped using guns when I realized that the way we make boys, men, fathers, presidents, and guns in this nation is the violence. The way we never really have honest conversations about what bullets, poverty, anti-blackness, cis-heteropatriarchy, and negligence do to unruly, vulnerable bodies is the violence. the way we never reckon with what bullets, poverty, anti-blackness, and cis heteropatriarchy and systemic negligence do to the insides of powerful white bodies in this country is the violence. And sadly, these kinds of violences leave messes that black women and girls usually have to clean up. If we really want it to be a less violent country, we really want it to be less violent people, we would welcome as many vulnerable folks as possible into this country. We would commit to a living wage. We would stop scapegoating undocumented immigrants and start dealing with how much pleasure we actually derive from violently keeping immigrants of color out of a country strangely built by immigrants of color, indigenous peoples, and stolen black folk. We would commit to a national 7-to-1 teacher-student ratio. We would commit the most of our money, we would commit most of the educational money in the school, to schools in this country with the poorest communities, in the poorest communities. We would demand not metal detectors, but comprehensive courses in sexual violence, domestic violence, gun violence, economic inequality in our schools. We would have substantial conversations about disarming police, abolishing prisons, providing robust universal mental health care for every child in the nation. We would call American foreign and domestic policy American terror, and our criminal-minded president a democratically elected white Christian American terrorist. We would be honest about how America encourages us to lie, manipulate, harm ourselves, and code our emotional and bodily cracks before tracing those cracks back to their origins. If we wanted this nation to be less violent, I wish I could tell William Faulkner, white folk actually have to have a devotion and fidelity to black folk. Men have to have a devotion and fidelity to women. Cis heterosexual folk have to have a devotion and fidelity to trans folk, gender non-conforming folk, and queer people all across this world. And grown folk have to have a devotion and fidelity to children. One truth might be that we can love our children in this country better than we have. Another truth might be that we can resist. Another truth might be that we can organize. But the truth that I'm most afraid of is that we have not loved children in this country enough to change our relationships to violence. If we bring this truth in every space we enter, every space we long to bring a gun, and all the other less spectacular but equally brutal forms of violence we tote in our hearts and heads daily, our children will not be safe, but they will be safer. And they'll be far less addicted to the violence than we are. Friday afternoons in Oxford, there's a lot of traffic that goes by my house on the way to William Faulkner's home. I often imagine what Callie Barr and William Faulkner would think about the country that made an outwardly racist, sexist, less than mediocre, violent, white reality TV star king because he was an outwardly racist, sexist, less than mediocre, violent, white reality TV star. I assume they would both say in their own ways, ain't no surprise when violence do as violence does. The relationship between Wayne Faulkner and Callie Barr means way more to me than it should, because I am that goofy and that Southern and that much of a Mississippian. I want to view the relationship cynically, but I know Callie Barr made William Faulkner's most dazzling narrative interventions possible, and I assume William Faulkner made parts of Callie Barr's life less vulnerable, maybe more materially secure, and possibly even joyful. But white folk will find no fidelity, and no devotion to a family that is not mine, in my body, or my work. Especially when that devotion comes at the expense of our own families, our own bodies, and our own mental health. That, more than guns, is the kind of violence that I must divest myself from. Divest or not, I wonder every day if my grandmama, my mama, my friends will find invisible guns next to my big black bullet-riddled body. I wonder whom I'm really protecting by never ever buying or borrowing a gun. If white folk and the police walk up on my Oxford, Mississippi porch where I'm finishing this essay and say they found what looks like a gun in the pocket of my sweatpants, please know that they are not telling the truth. If they tell you they found what looked like a gun in the glove compartment of my Prius, please know these folks are not telling the truth. If they tell you that I used a gun to harm myself because I was afraid, please know that they are not telling the truth. If they say that they saw what looked like a gun in between my big, thick thighs under one of my belly rolls or sticking out the crack of my juicy black ass. Please, please know that these folk are doing what they do best. They're doing what they do best, they're not telling the truth. My phone, my wallet, my remote control, my stuffed black squirrel, my burnt black toast, the black wave brush I use on my nappy black beard look nothing like guns, but I, like many of you in this room, look absolutely like a big black nigga. And as long as this nation believes in big black niggas, and as long as the phrase becoming a man is still a thing, no one should ever own or use a gun. No one who identifies as a man at least. As long as big black niggas are not allowed to be quiet or shy, no one should own a gun. As long as big black niggas will never have our gun violence asterisked by the fact that we were, quote, dealing with personal challenges, no one should own a gun. Big black niggas are guns to the most powerful, violent parts of this country. Being treated like a gun makes me always want to shoot back. But wanting to always shoot back makes me know I should never, ever on the gun. Please know and remember, no matter what they tell you, that I am a big black man, a big black teacher, a big black writer, a big black son, who does not own a gun because I know I will use it. I'm a big black teacher who will never bring a gun into my classroom, because I know I will use it. I'm a deeply Southern black man who is afraid to tell the truth, afraid to change, afraid to tenderly love myself, my people, and my invisible children. I want to end this essay with a bang, but I can't. So I'm asking myself, Kiese, do you care enough about the children of this country to begin divesting from all forms of American violence? And the answer I have to give myself is no. But guns, as quiet as it's kept, might actually be the easiest part. And the sad thing is most of us can't even put those down. Thanks.
Terror and open brutality of the South. In How to Survive as a Black Girl Everywhere in America, including the Deep South and American Happiness, the book as a whole, and in that great poem, Everybody in America Hate the South, you, Jacqueline, talk about how the South has taken the sin of America. You believe it's post-racial. But how is everywhere a place to feel othered as a person of color? So can both of you talk about the everywhereness of these issues? The media often has us think that the South is the only place that anything happens that's bad, that we're the only place that has, you know, HF sessions or X, Y, or Z.
Yeah.
I mean, now we all have them, so.
Yeah.
Sure.
Unfortunately. So can you talk about how that everywhereness happens, or how the media's portrayal has been wrong or right in its portrayal of the South?
So I think America's favorite word is obfuscation, because this is what we love best of all. And the South has just become a kind of site, a place we can point to and say, well, this is it. At the same time, we can ignore historically that all 13 colonies owned slaves, that you know, the bones that they found in, excavated in New York, they excavated children whose bones had been, the children had been worked so hard as slaves that the bones of their legs were literally ground down. But we don't talk about that, you know, because New York is a place of liberalism and progressiveness.
Right.
And so this is what we do, because America created for itself this narrative that obfuscates everything that created it. Everything that created it. The brutality that created it, the genocide that created it, everything that created it. And so how can I then tell the story and have people feel good about that history? Well, what I need is a redheaded stepchild to put the sins on. And so the South becomes the redheaded stepchild to put the sins on. And so, not that, you know, we don't have our own problems, but those problems are everywhere. Everywhere you are in America. Everywhere you are. And so you can't even have some of these discussions some places, because people will tell you straight up, well, you know, we're not racist, that's the South. Right. Right. We all know that that's not true. And so I think that what is, when Trump was elected, people began to say, oh, well, now all of America is going to look like Alabama. And I thought that was a really interesting statement, because I said, well, all of America has always looked like Alabama, right? And so I think it's just it's a way of preserving a narrative that is not true to create this sort of Southern scapegoat.
Thank you for that. So, you know, before Baldwin ever stepped foot in Mississippi, he wrote, I was gonna be a writer, God, Satan, and Mississippi, notwithstanding. So I just wanna say, I'm not just from the Deep South, like I'm from the belly, right? Like I'm from the one state where Alabama can look at and be like,
at least we're not Mississippi.
Yeah. Y'all can always look at us and be like, what's wrong with y'all? And I'm super critical of my state, but I am like, I love your first piece you wrote, because you read, I liked that first piece you read, because in a lot of ways I'm super defensive when people outside the South try to say anything about my region or my state, even when they're telling the truth.
Right.
Like, I moved to this country as town called Oxford, which is very different than Jackson, where I'm from. And the only place I can go to see black folk often is Walmart, right? And then so I had friends who were sort of leftist or radical come and be like, yo, what's up with that fucked up politics of Walmart? And I too am like, you know, like I critique like the labor practices of Walmart. But in Mississippi, I'm like, is it really that bad? You know, I'm talking about Walmart, man. So I feel like that question is such an interesting question, because it really reveals But one thing that I will now see is that, like, I think when people critique the Deep South, you can't tell me you're not critiquing black folk, because the Deep South is the blackest state, blackest part of this nation.
That's right.
You know, Mississippi is the blackest state in the nation. So critique Mississippi, critique our, like, backwardness and whatnot, but you also gotta give us credit for being the creators of, like, the dopest artists ever. I think the creators of, like, what we call American morality came out of, like, American literature, which came out of American music, which came out of sorrow songs, which I think came out of Mississippi. And I just think there's something wrong with white folk, generally, but definitely the white folk in Mississippi. That's what I was trying to say. That partially in my piece is, like, those white folk know us down here. Like, they, like, I spent 15 years in New York, and I met white people who never met black folk.
Right.
You know, the folk that I rock with in Mississippi, like, they know us.
Right.
You know, like, they don't have an excuse to be as fucked up as they are, but I think the fact that they do know us, and the fear of what will happen if we actively organize and do what we maybe should do, or should have done a long time ago, I think brings out the worst in them. So I just think it's a paradoxical question, right? Like, I love my region. In some ways, the worst region in the country, and in more ways than we want to admit, I think it's the greatest.
Right.
Because we're here.
Right.
Well, kind of in that same vein, a lot of us who grew up in the South have this love-hate situation. I can remember distinctly when I was younger, I was like, I gotta get out of here, I'm so ashamed.
Right.
If I ever traveled anywhere, I was like, well, I don't have an accent, I'm not Southern, but I don't think I'm Southern. Did y'all have a similar experience growing up as Southerners? Like, how did you see the South as young people?
I couldn't wait to graduate high school because I thought, oh, I'm going to get a bachelor. And then I went to school in my same town. and then I went to graduate school in Missouri. And those are the weirdest people I've ever met. And I was like, oh my gosh. You know, it's like one of those places where even black people are rednecks and drive pickup trucks. It's just bizarre. And I thought, please God, let me get back to Alabama. And when I got back to the state line, I had to get out and kiss the ground. And one of my professors, when I was at Missouri, he says, you know, Southerners don't transplant well. And he was right, we don't. Because it's a weird that you understand. It's a weird that, you know, I think Nikki Giovanni said that, you know, it's great to, like, break down in the South. Because even if people don't like you, they'll help you. You know, they don't have to like you. They'll fix your tire, they'll buy you a tire, they'll give you some iced tea, you know, and send you on your way. And they don't even have to like you. And so there's something really kind of comforting about that. So I'll never leave the South. As crazy as we are and as messed up as we are, never.
So I was raised by, my mother was 19 when she had me, and she went to Jackson State University, and she went to grad school and she came back to teach at Jackson State. So I was raised on the campus of Jackson State University in Jackson for all of my life, and because of my mother and because of my mother's colleagues and because of my mother's political activities, I always wanted to stay in Mississippi, and more importantly, I wanted to stay in Jackson because I saw a lot of people who could leave Jackson were leaving Jackson. I didn't want to be one of those people that got kicked out of school over some stuff. I shouldn't have got kicked out of school. I got kicked out of school for taking a library book out of the library and returning it. I really got kicked out of school because of some of the stuff I was writing. So when I left Mississippi and went to Oakland College, I always wanted to come back, but I didn't think it was gonna take me 18 years, you know what I'm saying? Like, but I can say that one of the things I'm most proud of in myself is that 2 years ago, I taught at Vassar for 14 years, you know, I got tenure there, I was in New York, the place people say writers are supposed to wanna be. And I had the option to stay there or go to California or go anywhere else. And I just wanted to come back home because of what you said. You know what I'm saying? Partially, I wanted to come home because in my experience, a lot of people who could leave left. But I was clear that I wasn't coming back home to, like, bless the youth. You know what I'm saying? It wasn't like, I was like, no, I've cultivated my skills, and now I'm coming back to plant, like, all these, like, I was coming back home because mentally, spiritually, physically, I had gotten sick up north. And I really felt like one of the only places I could heal was home. And so I think people who do leave and come back, I really encourage us to come back sort of not thinking we're coming back to save people or something like that, because that's bogus. But often, I think we need to be clear about, like, the damage sometimes that is done to a lot of us, not just up north, but particularly in New York. It's an amazing city, an amazing city. Most of my closest friends live there, but I think that place can damage people. And for me, I just had to come home after being so damaged.
Okay, so I'm gonna throw out a difficult question, because that's my job. So, you know, the title of this panel is 50 Years After MLK. So 50 years after MLK, where are we? What is the status of our country?
Oh! I think that's a super tough question. But it's tough because there's a part of me that wants to do that thing where, like, we haven't done anything in 50 years. I think that's really disrespectful to all of the folk, and particularly like the black folk on the ground in the Deep South who've been organizing and fighting and never stopped fighting. So I can't front and say, I mean, I'm here right now talking to y'all. 50 years ago, I don't know if I would have been. You know what I'm saying? This wouldn't have been here. We were talking earlier at dinner, you know, I have cousins who are gender non-conforming, and they will tell you they're gender non-conforming out loud in a fucking restaurant, and they're not looking behind them to see. Like, you can't tell me that that's not, I'm not talking about progress, I'm talking about for them, that is liberation.
Right?
So, I think we have made liberatory strides, but I also think on some level, like, that we haven't. And I think we can talk about masculinity, and I want to talk about patriarchy, but, and we should, and we need to talk about that, but we also just need to talk about, I don't know what's wrong with white folk. You know what I'm saying? Like, I don't know what's wrong with white folk. I don't know. You know what I'm saying? I always think about this reparations question, and how we, of course, we deserve a break. But, like, if you gave our $50,000 is not a lot of money compared to what we all were owed. Right. If you gave every black family in this country 50 G's and was like, we want you to vote for them up for Trump. We not doing that.
Right.
These white folk voted for that dude, and they weren't paid. and he was literally going to take their money. The poor ones, like, he was going to make life harder for them, and they did it anyway.
Right.
And they did it because a black dude, who I would argue loved them more than they deserved to be loved, was their president. I can't even understand. I
don't
understand.
That was smart.
You know, I still think it comes back. I think it goes back to Darius. In terms of our progress, yes, I think we have made progress. The problem is that it's hard to make up 400 years in 50. And so, you know, we think about people try to talk about the emancipation, 1863, all of this. But really, until we got voting rights, the Voting Rights Act, which has been good, by the way, until we got the Voting Rights Act, you can't make progress without representation. So I always say we're 50 years out of bondage, for real. And so I think we've made incredible strides in 50 years compared to the 400 we've been in bondage. So that's one thing. The second thing is, though, when you have a narrative that was created, when you have the race that was constructed for a very particular purpose, to promote privilege, to basically build an empire on the backs of people who are poor and colored and without representation, it is very hard to change that narrative. Because people began to believe, that's what they believe. And despite evidence before people's face, whether that be Barack Obama, where, you know, like, who was it who said, oh, when we got Barack Obama, we lowered the bar. And I'm like, really, dude? Okay. So, please explain that to me. Please show me that, because that's a really, if that's the low bar, then I must be on underground.
Right.
So I think that people will not invest themselves in that narrative, because this is what happens. If I have to give up that narrative, that not only have I told myself and my children, and my grandfather told that to me, and his grandfather told that to me, then I have to question my own history, my own positionality, my own sense of worth. And people don't want to start taking that hard look at themselves, because that's a whole psychological thing. And so I think that's problematic. So I think we've made progress, and I think we've got so much further to go. And I think demographics is going to take some of it. The other part of that I wanted to say is that mentality of that narrative is not just affecting white people, it has affected people of color. Because we are the recipients of that same narrative. So we have some work to do as people of color to shut off that story in our heads in order for us to make progress too.
Great answers. And if I'm ever on the panel that you are hosting, please feel free to ask me a ridiculous question. Okay, so the last question I'll ask, because I want to make room for other people's questions. Since we're all writers, I want to ask how you think literature or writing of literature, poetry, essays, how does that help with the struggle, or how does it help with the false perceptions of progress that y'all talked about? What does it do?
For me, all writing is political. Whether the reason is there to write, you know, even if you write about flowers and butterflies, that's a political choice that you're making to ignore something else. And so I think art, not just writing, but any kind of art, whether it be dance, fine art, etc., has the power to change. Because what happens is when people, it's very difficult for people to let their guard down when you have a conversation. Because folks are always looking for the argument, the angle, this, that, and the other. But sometimes if you read an essay or you read a poem or you read a novel, you're really looking to be entertained. And the ideas sometimes sneak in. And we are disarmed by beauty, or we are disarmed by inspiration. And so I think art is vitally important. Vitally important, and I think this is why politically we have places like the NEH and the NEA under attack. Because everybody knows art is vitally important. Art changes our perception. Music brings us together. You know, music has done more for understanding of people not like you than anything else. You know, and I think poetry and writing is a very similar kind of.
I guess I want to say two things. One, I obviously believe in art, and personally, like, I have to write, because if I don't write, I'm just terrible to myself and terrible to people close to me, which means I'm terrible to the nation and the world. So, like, for me, that is how I sort of reckon and try to, like, be less terrible, but also sometimes be just fair. I think it's really hard to be a fair American. But I also think I critique that part of myself often because, you know, the architects of empire read a lot. And I think they wrote. So I'm often, like, I often tell my students that, like, just writing and just reading and just painting and just sculpting is not, like, the work of liberation. Because a lot of the shit that I wasn't taught to imitate in terms of writing, that's what I'm talking about Faulkner, like, I was taught to imitate a lot of people who did not see me. And so what happens is, like, I could get okay at the craft, but really what I was doing was still sometimes writing myself out of my own art. And what I'm saying is that I think art is important, but really, I'm starting to think more that, like, art without liberatory teaching can be used in the service of empire, which means it can be used in the service of terror. Right. So I'm afraid of art. I don't think most of us have had liberatory teachers because our teachers didn't have liberatory teachers. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? So, and I don't think liberatory teachers just exist in classrooms. I'm talking about everywhere. Yeah. So,
I think you're right, but I think that's why you're important. And what you write is important. And I think what has to happen is that we have to have more access for people who create art, you know. And so it's, if you only have one voice, you know, the voice of the state, that's problematic.
Yeah.
But, you know, we're big, we collect a lot of artwork, fine artwork. And so you got Moe's tea sitting in his house, doing the thing, right? And so I think that's really important. So you've got to have that counselor. So it's why I'm still teaching. It's why I'm still teaching, because I want to create those artists out there who are going to go out there and change the world.
I'm like giddy, y'all. This is the best. Okay, so I'm going to talk to other people. Yes, sir.
So back to Mississippi, Crossroads, 1930s, Robert Johnson is probably the greatest blues guitarist of all time. Yet he had to make a deal with the devil to be that. Okay, so that alone right there, to me, personifies the hypocrisy of religion, most notably Christianity. And if you follow that all the way through from the Beatles and Led Zeppelin to Tupac and now Kendrick Lamar, the great hypocrisy seems to be Christianity, socioeconomic politicians, and it's not art. Art brings us together. So how do we deal with that? How do we take it from the crossroads of Mississippi, where a man literally took a six-string instrument and turned it into something that we can't put down today, to the hypocrisy of faith?
That's how they do. I don't have a long answer to that, but I agree with what you said, and but I'm a little concerned with like this sort of dialectic we make between like those artists who were like really, you know, pure or whatever, and corporate greed and stuff like that. Like I think they're weird, and I can't talk about anybody else. I can talk about myself. So, when I was like 26, I got a book deal from Pink, and I was writing this weird sort of metafictive book about these black kids in the woods in central Mississippi. Pink bought the book, and after they bought the book, they told me they wanted me to take it out of Mississippi. And I also should start by saying, like, I don't come from, like, wealth, right? We don't come from wealth. So meaning, like, I needed that book advanced. I needed to get tenure, like, not just to eat, but so, like, different people in my family could eat. So I took the money from Penguin. They said, we want you to move the book from Mississippi, put it in New York. I was a young writer, so I'm like, shit, I'll try that. Then they were like, we want you to change the narrator from like these multiple kind of black boy narrators to a white girl. And I'm like, that sounds weird. That sounds weird. But I was a young writer, and I was like, that's a test. Let me see if I can do that. So I tried to do it, and then they were like, we want you to take the racial politics out of your book. Now, a lot of y'all haven't read the book, what the fucking book is, like, exploration of racial politics. So then I was like, damn, why did they give me this money?
Wow.
And I was like, oh, they wanted to get a black boy from Mississippi who could write voice, what they call voice, to like write a narrative about a white girl in upstate New York, because that's what they wanted to sell more than the book, right? Like, it wasn't about me, it was about that. And because I don't come from shit, I mean, I come from a lot of wonderful stuff, but we just don't have money,
right.
I had to be like, damn, like, do I do it?
Right.
So I did what, on one hand, was the dumb thing to do, so I gave the money back, I left, I went with an independent press, I did use the internet to get out there and create a buzz for my work, you know, did some decent things with my work, and then those same people came back, trying to offer me more money than I ever imagined being offered for art. So at that point, I had to say, damn, like, what do I do? These mugs are offering me, like, mad dough for my family. Do I take it? And ultimately, I said no. But the crazy thing is that, like, just because I said no to this white corporation, it didn't mean I was saying yes to any, like, liberatory black corporation. I mean, I ended up going with Scribner, Simon & Schuster, which, and I wrote a book for, literally for black people. I wrote a book to my mother. My next book coming out called Heavy is written to my mother, I think, but then my editor is a white woman. Both my publicists are white women. My agent is a white man. The fucking editorial team of my place is all white. So what I'm trying to say is, like, I just don't think it's ever, like, pure. You know what I'm saying? Like, I don't think any sort of art that we consume in this country, regardless of where the fuck it comes from, it's not pure. So then the question is, what do we do with that impurity? And my problem is, I don't think we even talk about the impurity.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like, so I'm saying, as an artist, one thing I have to do, and that's why I appreciate your question, is talk about the impurity. There are people in here feeling me right now and all that kind of stuff. Please know, you're also feeling someone who has sold out often. Mm-hmm. Sold out often. Because why? Because we don't come from no fucking money.
Yeah, mine was more about the hypocrisy.
No, I understand. I'm just trying to riff off you. I understand.
You get that. So your question is about faith, about Christianity, about the hypocrisy of Christianity, about what?
Well, we've bedeviled Barack Obama.
Right.
Okay, that he was the Antichrist.
Right.
Okay, but we accept a man who's now president.
Right.
You know, we bedeviled Tupac.
Right.
We bedeviled Robert Johnson because he made a deal with the devil.
Right.
Where does Christianity come in all this that really is the hypocritical aspect of, it's the unifying factor of hypocrisy?
Well, you know, I don't know. That's really interesting. That's a really interesting take. But the church's role, the church historically has played a role in many atrocities. But the church, just like everything else, is constructed by human beings who are flawed and who use any institution available to them to do whatever evil they feel like doing. And so I'm not sure I'm not sure that Christianity is any more evil than Buddhism or Hinduism or Islam or anything else. I think I can take whatever gives me power over people and use it for whatever I wanted to use it for. And if this happens to be a country that purports to be Christian, then I can use some Christian buzzwords in order to sway people. So it's just a tool. It's like, you know, Amazon. Everybody hates Amazon, but everybody buys from Amazon. You know, everybody rags on Walmart, but Walmart, you know, they doing all right, right?
I feel you and I understand your question, but I also just think, yes, absolutely, but, like, you know, I don't want to connect some of the things I said. Like, my mother made me read a lot. She dissuaded me from reading a lot of, like, I think, liberatory black texts because she thought reading the white shit would protect me, right? So in the absence, so I would have to sneak to read Baldwin. I'd have to sneak to read Giovanni. But what I didn't have to do was I didn't have to sneak to be in my grandmama's living room after church when her and her sisters were having home mission. And at home mission, which was a black missionary Christian conceived space, I saw reckoning, I saw singing, I saw actual honesty, I saw actual listening, and I saw planning. And I just think those things are partially why we're in this room today. So, like, yeah, I want to critique Christianity all up and down, but I want to make sure, what I'm trying to say is, I want to make sure that the critique of Christianity holds space for, like, revelatory acts of actual liberation.
Right.
Like for those black women who work the chicken plants part of the day and work in white people's homes other parts of the day, to create a space around the Bible which was a space where they could talk about their experiences with all kinds of violence, including sexual violence and racial terror.
That's right.
For me, that shit was. I mean, I, Christianity has something to do with that. I'm not trying to sit here and try to defend Christians, but I am trying to defend my grandmother, who is a diehard Christian. You know what I'm saying?
Okay, so she was asking, what role does white supremacy play in the tension between the Latinx and the African American communities? The tensions that are created by people of color, between people of color. I think, you know, the function of white supremacy, is to reinscribe white supremacy. And so you reinscribe these kinds of structures by dividing and conquering. I mean, we could ask the same question about, especially sitting here in Birmingham, about what white supremacy, what role it plays in dividing poor people. You know, and so that you have poor white people, who go against their own interest in order to follow a racist agenda that is going to kill them, And so I think it's the same thing. So I think you divide people, and we create these fake groups in order to keep them fighting each other so they don't turn their attention on the structures that are really the problematic part of this whole equation.
And you said you see it every day, like maybe if you see it happening somewhere where you can necessarily in your community, like, hey, let's not, or you know, hey, let's try something else, that's a good step.
It's such a hard question because I don't want to center like whiteness and white supremacy like in everything that I say or write. So I think it's central, but I also think like I don't know if we can distinguish Americanness from white supremacy, but there's a race for Americanness. And like, I didn't understand that until I moved up to New York in 2001. September 11th happened. I went to New York City September 14, 15, and I saw brothers saying shit about Muslims that like, it confused me. Partially confused because I was from Mississippi, right? And I just, for me it was a binary, it was like white and black. And I met black dudes who were like, yo, you know they're trying to blow up Indian Point. And I was like, who? And he's like, the Muslims. And I was like, the Muslims. So I'm saying all that to say, I think there is a race to Americanness, which I think has to have white supremacy at its center. But I think people who write, people who have platforms, I think we have to be able to talk, not just to people to tell them to stop racing, to be American so much. And if you do race, like think about the consequence, but also, one of the things I have to do is, like, if you give me a mic, I need to talk about how I'm raised to be an American. And you can race in so many different ways, because I remember when I was riding the train down in New York that day, there was a Muslim family in front of me. I've written about this before. And I did that thing white people do where I was, like, trying to be the special black dude on the train. Like, trying to defend, you know what I'm saying? Trying to, like, people were talking shit about the Muslim family. I know they were Arab family in front of us, and I was like, y'all leave them alone. and then I was waiting for them to be like, thank you. You know, and so the whole trip, I'm like, the little boy's looking at me, I'm playing with him extra and stuff. But I wasn't doing it really out of care, I was doing it out of a sense, because I wanted to be exceptionalized as different. So I'm saying, part of what we have to do is be like, you got to tell the truth. Right. This race to Americanness is killing us, we'll kill other people, but we all susceptible to it.
Right.
You motherfuckers with microphones, you know what I'm saying? But when I got home that night, it was crazy. It's like, I was like, yo, I hope they don't fucking like, hope they don't bomb Indian Point. You know what I'm saying? The same thing that I was like, man, that's fucked up that brother was saying that. I really went into my apartment being like, damn, I think they're gonna airplane overhead. I'm being serious with you right now. So I'm saying, long stories, I just think, you have to be honest, but you can't stop at honesty. You have to realize that what you're being honest about is like your flaws, and you have to be able to actively regret. But you can't actively regret if you ain't honest about the flaws.
Okay, checking our time.
Yes, well, I would like to ask you about you as teachers, as educators and writers. How do you feel about the history books that the kids are getting at the public schools? And what can we do to improve that? And I'm asking that because my nephews came the other night and, come on, tell me the real thing. And I spent two nights thinking about the civil rights. So it's like, I think in Mexico I learned more about this than what they are teaching you.
Wow. Well, I have sort of two answers to that question. The one is that we have to realize that history books were constructed. There's a historical reason for that. It was called the Southern Plan, a way of writing history books in such a way to tell this narrative very specifically. And I think what's happening now, a lot of people are doubling down because we're all getting out of hand and asking questions. Okay. The second sort of answer to that is anything, things like books for school systems are chosen.
Right.
Are chosen. They don't just fall out the sky and hear them, you know. And so, and different school systems use different processes. But we have a voice. If you have a child, if you're a citizen, you pay taxes, you support that school system. What we have got to learn to do is to put pressure on people. And you know, pressure, you said constant pressure, but all kind of pressure you can put on folks, on people who get elected to school boards, on people who make these decisions at your superintendent's office or the central office or whatever they call it here. You can start letter writing campaigns, you can activate other parents, because if you can make a choice for a textbook, you can make another choice. And so I think that we too easily, and I'm guilty of this too, abdicate our power as citizens. We pretend we don't have any. Oh, somebody else made the decision. No, we let people make decisions for us. And believe me, look at some of the things that are happening. Like in Wisconsin, they basically, the legislature voted to take out of the mission statement, words like strive for truth and develop humanity and this kind of thing, search, seek truth, and to replace it with words like create a workforce.
Yes.
So to me, that means we're back to feudalism.
Right.
Just hold your row and don't say anything. But those people got voted in. They can be voted out. You can run for office. You know, you don't have to do all that. You decide this textbook is inaccurate and complete. You can write letters. You can get other people to write letters. You can start putting on social media. You can call it out. You can say how ridiculous this is. Blah, 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 blah. Complain, 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 complain. And you can make change.
I disagree with, I completely agree with that. And I also just think we can find history books in places that are not history books. Like, this is a history book. You know what I mean? In addition to being, you know, mesmerizing literary art, it's also a particular kind of history. So what? So that means, I think, in my experience, I remember my mother's students sometimes would get together and go around Jackson and create like what they call shadow curriculums at the time, which was like go to different public schools with the understanding of what was being taught, and like they were organizing young kids to teach them a different kind of history. I'm not saying that is the answer. But I do think like these shadow curriculums, and some teachers do this, right? Like some teachers I know at public school find ways to sneak in books. And I think the question is like, you know, will we ever get to a place where books do not have to be like smuggled in?
Yeah.
I mean, but that's where, I mean, I don't know about Alabama, but Mississippi, that is exactly where we are. Mm-hmm. In places where we need that the most, like in the Delta, I know a lot of really dedicated teachers who have to sneak books into you know, sneak books that don't call the Civil War the War of Northern Aggression, right? It's a spaceship, but you still have to do it. So I just think the answer is that we have to imagine, we have to organize, but we also, my point is, I think we can also use some of what's already existed. And I think that there's a lot of different ways to teach history, and like poetry might be one way, right? For people who are very thoughtful, very radical, and very interested in like actually like making America not just be better, but be more loving, right? And I think when I was listening to your work, I was like, that's what I heard. So I just think that's one way to do it. So thank you.
Because we believe in the power of language to cut through the obfuscation, like you were saying, to cut through the falsehoods that divide us and change the way we live together. And I think that's something that I feel a lot in this room tonight. It's something that I feel in this festival. It's something that I feel in this city. I'm very humbled and honored to be present for that. And humbled that our organization could have a part in putting this together tonight. Penn got connected to Ashley and Alina back in the fall when we were kind of conducting an outreach tour around the country, basically trying to figure out ways that we could engage local writers with different sorts of change in their communities. And this idea has sort of been percolating, I think, before we even came here. And through some resources that we were able to provide, we were not only able, I shouldn't say we, really Ashley and Alina, were able to not just put together this event, but to put together the first Magic City Poetry Festival. And I think that, I just want to give another round.
Tomorrow.